WRS online, worldradio.ch.
14 minutes away from 5, BBC World Service News at 5 o'clock. South African freedom fighter Albie Sachs is in Geneva tonight. He's being hosted by the International Service for Human Rights for a premiere screening of Soft Vengeance at the Maison des Arts du Grootli. The film chronicles his journey as a former judge of the South African Constitutional Court and key drafter of the South African Bill of Rights. Mr. Sachs was tortured whilst in solitary confinement for his efforts as a freedom-fighting lawyer and survived a car bombing attempt on his life in 1988, in which he lost an arm and the sight on one eye. Albie Sachs, good afternoon. It is indeed a pleasure.
Good afternoon. Lovely to speak to you.
When the first post-apartheid elections were held in South Africa on the 27th of April 1994, how did you feel after devoting much of your life up until that point to the freedom of your country?
Huge mixture of emotions. Overall elation. We were fighting for the vote. One person, one vote in one country. You weren't white, you weren't black, you were just a citizen, human being voting. And the total elation. But it was very odd when I actually stood in the line and all it meant was just putting a little cross next to, as it happened, I'm giving away a secret, next to Nelson Mandela's picture on the ballot form. I thought it was so banal. And then I also felt these other people lining up with me, they did nothing to get freedom, and yet their vote counted for exactly as much as mine. I was really surprised by my reactions. Mm. But of course, that's the whole point of democracy. It's the great equalizer, even between the oppressors and the oppressed.
How has Nelson Mandela's death touched you?
He left the scene a long, long time ago. Even at the World Cup 2010, that's 4 years ago, he was kind of wheeled onto the big stadium in Johannesburg, and people were just joyous to see him, but he hardly spoke. So it's not as though it's made any practical difference or political difference. And yet we wanted him to live forever because he represented everything that was best and admirable in our society.
Mm. How well did you know him, Mr. Sachs?
Well, I worked with him, first of all, in the underground, to a certain extent, in resistance. And then afterwards, on the drafting of the Constitution, we frequently worked very closely together. And three times, I was actually asked by our Constitutional Committee to oppose him. He was insistent that the vote go to 16, 17-year-olds, and we were saying only 18-year-olds. Mm. And we had quite a tussle and eventually kind of gave way rather grumpily. So that was a very direct encounter. And he told that story against himself years later to say that he was wrong and presidents can be wrong, and he was dropping a big hint to his successor as president, taking what many thought was a rather odd position on HIV/AIDS.
Prior to that election in 1994, what motivated you during that turbulent and dark period, that period of resistance that you've just referred to?
You know, people speak of a dark period. It was a period of dark repression, but that hope that burnt inside ourselves and the sense of humanity and comradeship and the musicality of the African population and the songs and the energy and the jokes and the laughter. I remember it as a time of dread, for sure. People were being assassinated, tortured to death, but very much as a time of active resistance inside the country and internationally. We got huge support internationally. But then we were trying to bring something down. And then came the marvelous period where we could build up. We could now start reconstructing our country, get a great constitution, and create mechanisms. We still have huge divisions in South Africa, but we can resolve them not through fighting, not through being at each other's throats, not through guns, not through assassinations and torture, but through argument, through debate, through elections. And we have the courts playing a very, very prominent role in our society. So I think we've made huge progress.
You're in Geneva this evening for the premiere screening of Soft Vengeance at the Maison des Arts du Grootli. Tell me about the film and what you'll be doing in Geneva this evening for the premiere.
Yes, Well, I was invited by the International Service for Human Rights, a Geneva-based body, to come and address them, and I couldn't make the actual date that they suggested, but I said, I'm getting an honorary degree at Cambridge University, and on my way back to South Africa, I could stop by, and they said, wonderful, and I mentioned that this film had been made about my life, and they said, well, let's show it, particularly to human rights organizations, which, of course, are very well represented in Geneva. It runs for 82 minutes. It's made by Abby Ginsberg. She's a filmmaker in California, in Berkeley. And I think she's done a terrific job.
When you sat down, Mr. Saxon, and saw that film for the first time, Soft Vengeance, you were there. You were the person around which this film has been based. What were your thoughts and feelings upon seeing it on the big screen?
Well, I was seeing it with an audience for the first time. I saw it during the process of making it. I argued with her about all the details, and she said one day, Albie, it's your life, it's my film. But there was a kind of dialectic between us that I thought was very, very useful. But now seeing it with an audience, and how would my colleagues on the court react, and how would the public, some of whom were barely born at the time of democracy being installed in South Africa, how would they react? And I'm happy to say it seemed to go down very, very well. I mean, the audience tonight can judge for themselves. It's quality. But it's not what I liked. It's not a strident film. It's not triumphalist. It's gentle. It's got a soft quality that I think is very appropriate to the theme of the transformation of our country through negotiations, looking into each other's eyes, discovering humanity in the former enemy. That kind of spirit runs all the way through, and I think that gives us more chance for a solid future than simply smiting your enemy, being in charge, saying, now it's our turn.
Mm. Was there an emotional moment during the film that hit you, that struck a raw nerve, perhaps, and took you back to that point of resistance leading up to 94?
The part of the film that I can't look at to this day, and I've seen it now maybe 20 times in different countries, different audiences, there's scenes of me shortly after being blown up and a portion of my right arm that eventually had to be amputated is lying severed, and I can't bear to look at that, and my body being carried away. So I just sort of block that out. And I don't have a memory of that because I was kind of semi-conscious at the time. But to see it visibly as a spectator, I found that very, very harsh. But otherwise, there's lots of humor and fun and interesting comments by people in the resistance, people on the bench. It was so nicely assembled, and the editor becomes the true hero of that film.
Mm. It is indeed a pleasure to have you in the city this evening for that at the Maison des Arts du Grootli. As you mentioned, you're here with the International Service for Human Rights for a screening of the film. What is the current focus of your endeavours and your activities?
I'm capturing as much as I can of the process. You know, it wasn't a miracle. It wasn't just the magician Mandela who transformed our country. It was thousands and thousands of people working in different ways, very hard, planning, arguing, debating, fighting at times. And our story is not as well told and captured as it ought to be. So first, the story of how we got the Constitution. Then the story of how we got the Constitutional Court, which I think is one of the most brilliant courts in the world, not just a great court in South Africa. It's pioneered a whole range of issues from same-sex marriages to striking down capital punishment to enforcing social and economic rights to dealing with issues of gender and so on. And I'm trying to record oral histories, get documents together while those of us who participated are still alive, so that people in future can understand both in our country and elsewhere where people are struggling against enormous odds to bring about major change, That's become my main purpose these days.
From the voices who actually experienced that period. I wanted to wrap up this afternoon with this question, and you've just alluded to conflict in other parts of the world, but we have conflict in so many areas around the world at the moment. Iraq in more recent days, Syria, the Central African Republic, the Ukraine, to name a few. What are your thoughts, Mr. Sachs, on bringing greater peace and stability to the world, that someone who went through a similar situation of crisis and conflict in South Africa?
Well, you know, both at a personal level and professionally as a lawyer and a judge, and just like as a human being, I think the South African experience establishes, first of all, no problems are intractable. We were given no chance at all after 300 years of white domination, racist oppression in its most violent form. How could we possibly live together in one country? And we've got immense problems, but we're living together. I think that's a positive thing. Then at a very personal level, I emphasize this theme of soft vengeance. Soft vengeance isn't doing to them what they did to us. It's not saying now we're in charge and we'll show who's boss. It's saying how can we transcend the conflicts of the past and find something in the enemy who becomes the opposition, who becomes your fellow citizen. How can we look into each other's eyes and find ways and means of agreeing to live together peaceably? And I think that's been the remarkable experience of South Africa. Our Truth Commission is one well-known episode in it, but it was only part and parcel of a major democratic transformation in which millions participated in different ways. And what I sense in so many other countries is an old tyranny has been overthrown, or is being challenged, but it's replaced by new forms of tyranny where there isn't an emphasis on inclusion, there's an emphasis on domination and control, and ultimately that leads to counter oppositions being formed. We followed a different route, and I think our example, we look at other positive examples, Northern Ireland, they have problems, but they're living together now, they're talking. I think it's the talking, the negotiating, rather than conquest through arms and a superior physical force. That's got to be the way forward.
You speak so beautifully, and it's been a pleasure to listen to you this afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us here on Drive Time.
And thank you.
Enjoy your stay in Geneva. South African freedom fighter Albie Sachs, who is in Geneva tonight, he's being hosted by the International Service for Human Rights for a premiere screening in the city of Soft Vengeance at the Maison des Arts du Grutli.